The year 2017 is the 100th anniversary of what Marxists consider to be the greatest single event in human history. Now, why do we say this? Well, here, for the first time, if one excludes that glorious but brief and tragic episode of the Paris Commune, here for the first time, the masses, that is to say, the millions of ordinary men and women, not political activists, but ordinary people, moved to overthrow the tyranny of the old Tsarist regime, which had lasted for hundreds of years, and at least began the great historical task of the socialist reconstruction of society. Yes, they began this great task. The fact that it didn't finish in the way that they anticipated, that's a separate question which we can deal with on a subsequent occasion. But nobody can take away from the Russian workers and peasants that colossal achievement, that they began the task, which is, of course, the historic mission of the working class, to transform society along socialist lines. And, you know, the extraordinary thing about this, there are many extraordinary aspects of this. But first of all, the observation I would make is that Russia at that time, Tsarist Russia, was a backward country in every respect of the word. It was how backward? Well, far more backward, for example, than Pakistan or India at the present time. Can we quantify this backwardness? Well, yes, we can. Now, just imagine an enormous subcontinent, a country of a gigantic population of 150 million people. Out of 150 million people in Tsarist Russia in 1917, how many workers were there? Well, industrial workers, in the strict sense of the word, less than 4 million, about 3.5 million, mainly concentrated in the west, in the western part of Poland and western Russia, and the areas around Moscow and St. Petersburg. You see, but not only that, Tsarist Russia was an autocracy. It was a monstrous oppressive regime. I mean, some people try to paint the old regime in glorious technicolor, you know, compare it favorably with Bolshevism. But of course, this is utter nonsense. Tsarist Russia was a monstrous regime of police terror. With a huge army, the Tsar had a huge army, the biggest army perhaps in the world at his disposal, a huge police force, a huge apparatus of secret police, the Okhrana, which extended its tentacles everywhere, including the political parties, including the Bolshevik Party, which was infiltrated right up to the top level. This was only discovered, the extent of the infiltration was only discovered after the October Revolution. Trade unions were not allowed. Strikes were not allowed. Demonstrations were not allowed. Free speech was not allowed. The press was strictly censored. Education was controlled with an iron hand, not just by the regime, but by the Russian Orthodox Church, which exercised, if you like, a spiritual dictatorship over the souls and minds of men and women, as the Tsarist police exercised over their bodies. It was a monstrous regime. Yes, and something else I'd like to point out, which is generally not realized. Tsarist Russia played a similar role, if you like, in the sense that many parallels, with that played by American imperialism at the present time. It was one of the main imperialist nations in the world. As a matter of fact, it was the main bulwark of European reaction. Most of the revolutions, if not all of them, throughout the 19th century, were crushed under the leaden rump of Russian Tsarism. So therefore, it was the most counter-revolution, the most reactionary force on earth. Now just imagine the position. Just think for a moment, 100 years ago, a little bit more than 100 years ago. The position of the Russian Marxists, who set out at the beginning of the year, at the beginning of the 20th century, with very tiny groups, tiny isolated groups of revolutionaries, mainly students, some workers, of course, workers increasingly swelled the ranks of these revolutionaries, but they were a tiny, minuscule minority in this ocean of backward peasants and obscurantist and police repression and reaction. There'd been a revolution, an attempted revolution in 1905, which failed, which was crushed by brutal repression. And therefore, if one thinks of all of these things, it would seem on the face of it that revolution in Tsarist Russia would have been an impossibility. I mean, I can imagine the reformists and those who oppose revolution would make out quite a good case, saying that it was utterly impossible, given the odds, given the strength of the state, that the revolution should have succeeded at all. And yet, succeed it did, and carried out the greatest social transformation, I would say, in the entire history of the human race. Now, I realize in making this comment that it's not fashionable to defend the Russian Revolution. Now, we can expect, I'll deal with this perhaps in a later lecture, we can confidently expect in the course of 2017 a positive avalanche of books, of articles, of speeches, of television programs, of all kinds of learned professors who come out of the creep out of the woodwork in order to, only with one purpose, to slander and attack the Russian Revolution. And of course, the fashionable argument is, it's frequently repeated, not least in Russia itself, since the collapse of the Soviet Union, there's been an industry, paradoxically, all kinds of cynical individuals who previously sang the praises of so-called communism and sang the praises of Stalin and the rest of it. Now, of course, they're singing the praises of capitalism and making quite a pretty penny out of it in the process. And the main argument put forward, there are many arguments, which I will deal with one by one, but just concentrate on one for the time being. It goes like this. Oh yes, the Russian Revolution was a complete and absolute disaster. And if only the Russian people would have been left alone and Lenin hadn't interfered with his Bolsheviks and so on, then Russia would have evolved naturally, gradually, peacefully into a wonderful capitalist democracy with free enterprise and with a market economy, which of course, as we well know, is the main guarantee of wealth and prosperity for the majority of the population, if you can believe that. Of course, if you can believe that, you can believe anything. Now, of course, the truth of the matter is precisely the opposite. Let me spell it out in very simple language. If Lenin and Trotsky and the Bolsheviks had not taken power in October 1917, what kind of a regime would you have had in Russia? I'll tell you. You'd have had Russian fascism if the Bolsheviks would have been defeated, for example, in the Civil War. Russian fascism, which, by the way, would have been an absolutely horrific animal. A really savage beast. You just look at the anti-Jewish pogroms, the bloody pogroms, organized by this wonderful Tsar, known to the Russian people before the revolution as Nicholas the Bloody. And now they like to present him in a different light, but this is the truth of the matter. Russians, fascism would have been a ferocious animal. 5 years before Mussolini took power in Italy, before the March on Rome, that's the regime you would have had, with all the, which would have been a nightmare for the Russian people and a nightmare for the rest of the world also. Russian Bolshevism, you say what you like, they saved the world. They saved the people of Russia in the first instance from that barbarism that was being prepared. But not only that. The latest revisionist ideas is, the planned economy was a disaster, Russia was a disaster, the Soviet Union never achieved anything. Oh, really? They never achieved anything? Good heavens above. Look, I've already said, Russia in 1970, Tsarist Russia in 1917, was an extremely backward country, more backward than Pakistan at the present time. Okay, the population, the mass of the population were illiterate. The situation was a complete disaster. There was very little industrial development. What little development there was entirely dependent on foreign capital. What's the position? Well, you know, despite everything that can be said about the Soviet Union, it proved one thing, and that's why they can't forgive it. That explains the hostility which they have. The Soviet Union, for all its faults, for all the problems that undoubtedly did exist, product of backwardness, nevertheless, proved one thing without a shadow of doubt. It proved that it is possible to run a successful economy in a vast country of 150 million people without capitalists, without bankers, without stock exchanges, without speculators, and without landlords. Oh yes, oh yes. It proved that beyond a shadow of a doubt. The planned economy in the Soviet Union, the nationalized planned economy instituted by the Bolsheviks, despite all the bureaucracy and the problems created by Stalinism after the revolution, after the death of Lenin, nevertheless, doesn't matter. The Soviet Union was transformed in a remarkably short space of time from an extremely backward semi-feudal country to one of the most advanced industrial nations on earth. Oh yes, the planned economy, by the way, had a growth rate. This is astonishing. The first five-year plans, it's true they set out from a very low base, I will accept that, but nevertheless, it doesn't change the substance of the argument. Every year in the first five-year plans, the Soviet Union had a rate of growth of 20%. I mean, this is staggering if you consider now that if Britain or America gets 1 or 1.5%, they're in ecstasy. The stock exchange soars. The Soviet Union, my friends, had in the first five-year plans, had a rate of growth of approximately 20% per annum with full employment. There never was any unemployment in the Soviet Union. Unemployment, as a matter of fact, was a criminal offence. It was considered to be parasitism. No unemployment, no inflation, at least after the initial period, but they did make some mistakes, but they solved the question of inflation. Prices were stable. Rents were virtually non-existent in the Soviet Union. When I was studying there in 1970, it's true that the housing was pretty basic. There were small flats and so on. Yes, but you compare that to the monstrosity of mass homelessness. Thousands of people sleeping on the streets of London in the year of our Lord 2017. There was none of that in Russia when I was there. Hardly any rents. The rents were extremely low, virtually non-existent, and they included free gas, electricity, and even telephone calls in the Moscow region was free when I was there. This is nothing. What about health? In Tsarist Russia, if a peasant fell ill, he would die for lack of medical attention, of course. Under the Soviet Union, they built one of the finest and most advanced health services on earth, with a mass of doctors, many of them women, by the way. That's another one of the gains of the Russian Revolution. Before the revolution, women in Russia were enslaved to the men, had no rights. The husband had the legal right to beat and torture his wife, and nothing could be done about it. All that was finished by Bolshevism, which created genuine freedom and emancipation and equality, for complete equality for women. Huge amount of women entered the professions in the Soviet Union. Doctors, teachers, university lecturers, agronomists, you name it. These were gigantic gains. Now, of course, all the lies, and there's a torrent of lies to minimize and to deny this, it's complete nonsense. Let me just quote one example, which is self-evident. The space program in the Soviet Union. The Soviet space program, it's shown, it's proven even recently by the CIA, of all people, that even when the Soviet Union collapsed, the Soviet Union had, by the way, they had more scientists and engineers and technicians than America, Britain, France, Germany, and Japan combined. And they were damn good scientists. No doubt about it. The space program proves the point. The CIA admits that even in the 1980s, the Soviet space program was 10 years in advance of the USA. They tried to disguise the fact by putting a man on the moon for all that was worth and so on and so forth, but that was just propaganda. The Soviet program was infinitely in advance. I can prove it very simply. If you just look at the television news and you see, for example, they put a British man into space and so on, yes, in a Russian spaceship, in a Soyuz space capsule. Even at the present time, despite the collapse of the Soviet Union, they still have to use Russian rockets and Russian space stations in order to carry out the space program. I could cite many other examples. Not just the Soviet Union, by the way, but in Eastern Europe, when they introduced also a system of nationalized planned economy, you had similar developments, similar improvements. I studied when I was in university in Bulgaria for 12 months. I could speak Bulgarian and I observed the country and so on. But Bulgaria before the 1940s, before the Stalinists took over, before the nationalized planned economy, was an equally backward, semi-feudal, illiterate country. You know, when I was there in the 1960s-67, Bulgaria had the greatest percentage, the highest percentage of young kids, of young people in higher education than any country in the world. Now you tell me, you look at these facts, my friends, and you tell me whether it was all a great mistake, whether it proved that the nationalized planned economy didn't work, that the private enterprise and the so-called democracy is superior. Well, is it? Was it? I don't think so. Furthermore, I believe that many people in the Soviet Union nowadays look back with regret, not to the dictatorship, of course. Socialism, in any sense understood by Marx, Engels, Lenin, or Trotsky, or myself, socialism must be democratic by its very nature, as the Paris Commune showed, as the early years of the Russian Revolution showed, that it was completely democratic. And really speaking, the Stalinist counter-revolution, which was the product of the isolation of the revolution in conditions of frightful backwardness, but that's a point we could discuss on another occasion. The Russian Revolution was actually the most democratic and the most popular revolution in history, okay? The Stalinist regime had nothing to do with that. The Stalinist regime destroyed the democratic basis of the Russian Revolution. Yes, but they maintained, as Napoleon maintained, the economic and social conquest of the French Revolution. So the Stalinists were obliged to base themselves on the most important aspect of the revolution, was the nationalized planned economy. And it did work, my friends. Now don't be misled by all the propaganda. It certainly did work for a whole period of time. The proof of that was in the Second World War, which in Europe, was reduced in effect to a titanic struggle between Hitler's Germany, with all the resources and the manpower and the industry of Europe behind him, and Russia and the USSR, that's all. The British and Americans really were mere onlookers. I'm sorry to say this because all the movies, you see how John Wayne or a few other American actors won the Second World War. Well, not so. The British and Americans were merely observers, onlookers, in this titanic struggle, which showed what? You see, it showed, first of all, the Germans, they smashed through France like a hot, in 1940, like a hot knife through butter, and they had Britain on its knees. The Soviet Union, despite the terrible losses, and half of those killed in the Second World War were Soviet citizens, 27 million on one account. 27 million dead in the wholesale destruction of industry. Yes. But you see, the resilience of a nationalized planned economy by the fact that they were able to put all the industries in the west of Russia on trains, ship them east of the Urals where they were safe from German bombers, and within 18 months, the Soviet Union was outproducing Germany in tanks, in guns, in planes, in artillery, and so on. And succeeded in something which the British and Americans and French failed to do. They smashed the German army, the German Wehrmacht, the mighty Wehrmacht, and staged the biggest military advance in the whole of history. As a matter of fact, that's why the British and the French hastily opened up the Second Front in 1944. Otherwise, they'd have met the Red Army on the English Channel. Now, this fact alone illustrates the superiority of a nationalized planned economy, which they now are desperate to deny, maintaining falsely that the only possible system, as Francis Fukuyama tries to maintain, the only possible system, of course, is the so-called free market economy. If I might make one parting remark to demonstrate the utter falsity of this argument. You see, let's go back to what I just said. In 1940, when the British ruling class really had their backs against the wall, when Germany was knocking at the door and threatening to invade, when they really were on their knees, when the situation was really desperate, what did they do? What did Churchill do? Did he say, oh, free market economy, decentralized, do your own thing? You know, the market will sort everything out. Did they? Hell. They centralized the economy. They introduced direction of labor. They had a plan. Of course, you can never have a proper plan on the basis of capitalism, but they had some kind of a plan, particularly for the war industries. They nationalized. Yes, they nationalized the war industries and allied industries and so on and so forth. Why? Why did they do this? Well, very simple reason. Because a planned economy works better. QED, full stop. A planned economy gives better results. That's why they did what they did. This is a confession, in effect, of the bankruptcy of capitalism, the bankruptcy of market economy, and the superiority of a nationalized planned economy, which even with all the evils of bureaucracy, which is a separate subject we have to deal with under the question of Stalinism, and the reason why finally the Soviet Union collapsed. Nevertheless, despite that, socialists, all people interested in fighting for a more just world, must take note of the fact that the Russian Revolution, in that sense, was a colossal success, not a failure at all. An enormous success which proved, as Trotsky said in his wonderful book, The Revolution Between, prove the superiority of a planned economy, not in the language of dialectics and the three volumes of Capital, but in the language of steel, cement, electricity, and I would add, yes, also spaceships.